I'm Paramatma Saran. I'm professor of sociology at Baruch and also happens to be vice chair of this institute. I'm chairing this panel. We have two members here, Dr. Ashwin Pandey on my right, and then on his right is Ms. Mala Desai. We would reverse this order because Ms. Desai has to be somewhere else shortly. Okay. We are starting at, I would say we would at least have 15 minutes each for your presentation, give and take, and then we'll have ample time for discussion. Usually I stay away from big introductions because we have this practice, you know, we have everything right here. very briefly say that Mala Desai is the founder and chairperson of Pragati, an organization for South Asian women and families in Queens. Just a small note on my part before we get started. I'm a sociologist. I started doing work on looking at the experiences of Asian Indian community in this country in mid-70s. Basically, people started coming in late 60s and early 70s and all that. And guess what? What were the issues then? Discrimination, employment, adjustment, relationship between children and parents and so on and so forth, right? Obviously, we have come full circle. Now we are looking at situation of senior citizens, right? And
yes, of course. Yeah.
Right? And so, you know, we have come to full circle and the issues have changed quite a bit. I remember those days, most of my respondents used to say that it's a matter of time, 10, 15, 20 years, whatever, you know, once they get settled and their children get settled, you know, of course children will stay here, but they would go back, right? Including myself. Now, we are all here with our gray hairs, right? And working on our wills, whatever. I have no expertise in this area at all. I have not focused my research on the experiences of elderly Asian Indians, but there are two people who are going to share their thoughts with us. The title of the panel is Senior Citizens and Other Ethnic Groups. It is somewhat misleading. It does not really emphasize on the issues we are going to talk about. Dr. Pandey pointed out that on website it says health-related issues of this particular group. Whatever it is, we are going to run it in a very informal way. Ask you, Mr. Sai, to present your thoughts first.
Thank you so much for inviting me here today. First of all, there is a correction in the brochure. I'm not Dr. Desai. I am a community organizer. My background is in social work. And then I went on to study nonprofit management. And I started out in America. I arrived in New York in 1992 and I started volunteering for the South Asian women and families. And we created Pragati. So that's my true identity. And then doing that work, we got organized around health issues, which took me to the Northern Queens Health Coalition, which is a coalition of over 60 organizations in Queens. And what we do there is community organizing by creating programs. It's the members who identify specific needs that residents in the communities are facing with regard to access to healthcare. And then it becomes my job to bring people together to work as partnerships, networks, and in collaboration to meet those needs and then identify resources so that we can get the services. So the focus really is on getting real services to real people who are having a very hard time understanding how to take care of themselves and very often also understanding how the system works. I brought some flyers for you and some materials and we can send them out later. I also printed up, this is right off the internet and this was done last night, services for seniors which are available through every department for the aging in the across the country. How many of us are aware of the services that are available? Even when I was looking through this listing last night, I said, oh my God, I was aware of some, but look at what even I don't know that's out there that we have not organized around and we have not tried to create a program to get to our people. So I'm not going to go through it. You can read it. And you can see the wealth of services that are funded and are available for our seniors. So the website is listed right there. And each bullet point that you see is actually a link that then takes you into further information and further details about those services. And if you get to the Department for the Aging website, our local New York City Department of Aging website, there again, there is a wealth of information which locally gives you a connection to the local agency that's providing you the service in your own neighborhood. And that's a quickie on available resources which we need to learn about and educate ourselves about. And it's a simple way to do that. The other way, if you do not have internet access, now we have the number 311. In New York City, which has become the catch number for every kind of thing. But it has really worked for the work that we do in Queens, because people call 311 and they get hooked up to identify what their need is. Sometimes they self-identify, and sometimes it's the worker who has to ask a few questions to see what exactly it is that the person is looking for. And then they connect you while you're still on the call to the local agency. It's a direct connection. And we have in my office, which is the coalition office, we do not do any direct services at the coalition office, we have received those calls and then forwarded the referral to the local agency. So that's how we can start to access resources and learn about what's out there for our seniors. A little bit about Pragati. Pragati is an organization for South Asian women and families. It started out because our South Asian women really did not know how to get what they needed to get. We started out with a very simple ESL class held on the weekends with four or five women coming in. And now last year we completed 10 years. We are providing the full range of social services. It's a very small nonprofit that sits in the basement of a Jewish academy and is doing amazing work. And it is, I have a flyer for you in Bengali, and it's the one program that we started as a part of our partnership with caregivers with the Northern Queens Health Coalition, and that's on the other side, which is in English. And Pragati started doing caregiver services 3 years ago, and we have experienced such an amazing range of demands. And we need to get ourselves better organized to create more programs. Because in Queens, for South Asian communities, as you're aware, there is absolutely no service. Where do we send our people to get the service? At this time in Queens, we have one senior center, which is the only vegetarian senior center probably across the country, and I'm sure you've all heard about it. It's the United Hindu group that was created with the Department for the Aging funding in Richmond Hill. But there again, not all of our seniors are able to get to that one center, and it's not meeting the needs of the diversity of the South Asian community. Because as you know, the diversity of the South Asian community itself, you have isolated pockets of people who come together based on their religious needs and or on their language needs. So you have groups which are not being reached. Well, Pragati is a place that we start, and it does a lot of information and referral. It is the entry point for people to call, and if Pragati cannot provide the service, they connect them immediately to a service that can be provided by another agency. And here I'll give you an example which is related to the caregiver services program. The caregiver services program, what it does, and I had the whole write-up, but I don't think I'm going to go into it. But if you want more information, again, you can do the search on the internet on the Administration on Aging, and you will find a lot of information about caregiver services. What we provide for our caregivers is a lot of counseling, education, emotional support. And we have, as our partnership at the coalition, 7 organizations that are meeting the direct service needs. And as I said, these are counseling, a lot of education, trainings. We are also able to cover some costs that are incurred by the family for various things like medicines. We have even bought groceries for people, transportation. We have paid telephone bills for people. Small things like that which become a burden for the caregiver when the person is not well. We have also managed to reach out and educate our community about what is respite care. And how, if you see the statistics and the data, you know that over 78% of the elders who are with a chronic or a serious illness are being cared for across the country by people, by the family and friends. They are in home and they are being cared for by people at home. And that is a burden, and that does, you know, influence the quality of life of the family and also of the individual. But we also know that people want to be cared for in their home. People do not want to be away from home. They do not want to be in a facility, in an assisted living or a nursing home or a long-term care facility, unless it's really required. They want to be at home. And this program is meeting that need. But what it does do is, what happens to the caregiver? And respite service is, in-home respite is where we are providing home care, certified home health aide, who goes into the home for a few hours a week. And that relieves the burden and gives the caregiver a break to, you know, take care of themselves. So this program has one guest example of how we work together as a partnership, and also how we bridge the gap between healthcare and social services is, we got a call, Pragati got a call from a family who had seen the ad. We advertise, this is in Bengali, but we also advertise in the Desi talk, the Indian newspapers, and the Urdu newspapers. And they saw the ad in either a Gujarati daily or the, you know, in one of the ethnic newspapers. And the situation was that an 88-year-old lady had fallen down and hurt herself, speaks only Gujarati, and was in the hospital, of course, and was being discharged. And the discharge planners and the social workers and the hospital, you know, the physicians, they did not know how to send her home because she needed in-home care after she was sent home. And she needed someone. She couldn't communicate with anyone other than the family. And the family, husband, wife, are both working. So they said, how do we take care of her? So we said, okay, we have respite care, but then it has to be someone who speaks only Gujarati. That's when they found the ad and they called Pragati and they said, we need a Gujarati speaking in-home attendant. And we said, okay. And we did the research. Our caseworker from Pragati contacted the family, got in touch. And then we realized that, you know, we work only in one region of Queens. The family was not in our region of Queens. And so we now needed to, and Pragati does not have a social worker, certified social worker. The family needed a full assessment, which had to be done by a Gujarati-speaking social worker, which was really hard to find. So we referred the case to our local social service agency, and they had an intern, social work intern, who connected with the family and spoke to the lady and set up, through the discharge planning process, some care for the lady at home. And then after we did that connection, we realized that the lady actually does not live in our region. So we then forwarded that call to the agency that provides the service in that region where she lived, which was Belrose, which is southeast Queens. We are northern Queens. So that's just giving you an example of how we are starting to connect people to rail services as a rail need arrives, and bridging the gap between how to support the family when they're at home and when they need to be taken care of, and we are trying to meet the language needs. Of course, when such things happen, it, you know, makes you aware of the fact that the home care industry does not have Gujarati speaking home care attendants. And if they do have them, you know, it's hard to find someone so immediately to place. But, you know, it's a challenge, and we continue to do that. I also brought some information, and I'll stop with that on the technical aspects of my presentation, and you can ask me questions. We are having an event, which is our Caregivers Night Out, which is on the 14th of June, so please join us. As of today, I had the flyers in 7 languages. By Monday, I'll have them in 10. But I did bring the Asian languages with me. And Betty Cheng, who was speaking earlier, happens to be the president of the coalition, and she found some errors on the Chinese flyer. So it's being revised. But the error really was that if you see the Chinese flyer, it says home care service. It doesn't say caregiver service. So I said, let the flyer go out so at least people will start knowing, and we'll make the correction, and on Monday I'll have a revised one. But please take the flyer, and if you are working with people who, you know, need to read it in the language, I have it in Chinese, Korean, Bengali, Urdu, and Gujarati. So help yourself to those. And then this is a flyer about our caregiver services in English, and then I brought the Bengali one. And we are also doing a lot of work on Medicare D. Now, we've all heard about Medicare D. And Pragati is providing medical education, outreach, and actually helping people complete the application online. And that is again with Department for the Aging funding, with CMS funding. And this flyer is in Russian and English, because this, in my office, we have a Russian speaking staff, Russian and Spanish speaking staff, who are doing this. And you cannot imagine today what the situation is in my office. I am so glad that I haven't been there since the morning, because 15th, as you know, is the cutoff date. We were hoping for an extension, but that did not happen. So 15th is the cutoff date. And the ads are out there, and seniors are panicking. So I asked my staff if they could come in and work on Saturday, and they cannot. So today is a crazy day for them, and Monday will probably be even worse. But we are providing that assistance, and Pragati is providing that assistance. People can call, make an appointment with our staff there, and online, Pragati staff and staff in my office will help people complete their application. So I did make extensive notes, but I think I'll stop with that. And if you have questions, we can open up.
Thank you very much, since you have to leave.
Yeah, I have to leave at 4 because I have a class at 4:30 to teach.
Okay, so if you don't mind.
Yes, sure.
We will take 2 questions and comments before she leaves. Yes.
I have one quick question. I'm a gerontologist, and I really don't know anything about the Indian community. So could you just, any type of barriers, anything I need to know, as with the Chinese community we learned today, different things. I'd like to know more about the Indian community. What would you want to teach her, tell me that I should know?
As an overarching principle for elders is that elders are to be taken care of by their adult children in the home. It is considered to be a real shame if the elder is not in the home with the son or the daughter. It's like, you know, custom and what is dictated, not by religion, but by custom and tradition and family practice, that it's the son who has to take care of the elder parents, right? So the burden does fall on the daughter-in-law. And my father does not have a son. So we are 3 daughters, and my parents are in India. So we are challenged. But it is, you know, something that we have to deal with. But the issue is really that they want to be at home and they want to be taken care of by their children. Now, when you are here in America, and that is not a reality, because here you are not a family with extended support system. You are an isolated unit, and you cannot survive if both adults are not working. And once children are teenagers, they really don't exist. I just have 2 teenagers who left home for college, and they kind of never existed for the last 5 years. So you're alone. The issues over here are loneliness. Elders become dependent on their adult children, which they are not back home. Even today, my parents are completely independent. They have their own life. They have their own social network. They have their own family network. And it's okay if the daughters are not with them. But when they come here to visit us, they hate it. You know, they enjoy the first week. And if I look around, and other, you know, grandparents who have come and migrated and are here, it's really hard to connect them with a social network that is close by, where they're not dependent on the children to take them back and forth. So the activities get limited to the weekend. And the activities get limited to, let's go to the temple. And that's their social life. My mother has never gone to temple. So she says, don't tell me to go to the temple. I'm not going to the temple. You know, that's who she is. She does her prayers at home. Her temple is her home. And she says, I don't want to be here. I'm completely lost. You go to work. Take the day off. You know, when I'm here, you take the day off and stay with me. So that's a gap. That's a very serious gap. Now, when they fall ill, the burden becomes even more. So the main issue is of isolation, lack of even the ability to travel to and from where they need to go. And if you get deeper into the issues, yes, there is abuse. Yes, they are the babysitters. Yes, they are financially completely bereft of what they have. And the issues get very complicated.
Thank you so much.
And you said there was only one senior center.
there is one senior center, and when we try to hook them up to the local senior center, I'm challenged with another couple. The gentleman is 84 and the wife is 78. And she's the one who was identified as being in psychiatric need. And when I went in and I met them back in October, and within the first meeting, there was a volume of outpouring that the lady, from the lady I got. She didn't know me. And it was just through a friend, through of a friend of a friend, and I hooked up and I said, let me meet them to see, you know, where she's at. All she needed was to connect with the rest of the world, because what her life was, she makes jewelry and she used to have a jewelry store in Manhattan, and today she's sitting at home and she's completely dependent on her husband, who is retired, very well to do. They're not lacking in funds or money, but he has prostate cancer and he is, you know, her caregiver, but he needs help too. How to get them out and connected to a senior center is a real challenge. And we're working on it. That's another case that, you know, I'm waiting for my caseworkers to tell me, you know, the house needs to be cleaned. And I said, let's get house cleaning done. And for them to allow someone to just come in, for him to acknowledge that he's 84, for him to acknowledge that I cannot, it's not okay for me to be doing the vacuuming on two floors. And she's not doing it, she's depressed. You know, so those are the kinds of issues. They're completely isolated.
And the daughter-in-law is reluctant to get help.
They don't have children.
Okay.
This couple.
I'm just saying, just in general, the daughter-in-law would not try to get services because then it's a shame. She should.
It's a shame for her to bring in some help.
Because we work for City Meals on Wheels. And
yes.
I probably attempted to contact United because we wanted to offer homebound
yes.
meals.
Yes.
For that community, and
it's a challenge.
Her
no,
and, you know.
It's a challenge because the you know what, hook up with Pragati for Meals on Wheels, because we had a lady who came to us for ESL to complete her citizenship, and her husband with Pragati for 5-6 years became a citizen, and just 2 weeks ago was diagnosed with cancer. So an old client now suffering, and we need to get every service we can in there. So,
but as a follow-up to
yes.
her question, you rightly said that in the Indian tradition, it's the responsibility of the family, particularly son,
yes.
to look after elderly parents. Now, if they're living here, it's something simply not practical. You know?
Yes.
So even if their parents need any help and all that, they are reluctant to go to centers or talk to anyone, you know, avail these agencies, you know, things of that
yeah.
sort. You are rightly saying, you know, it's a big challenge. I'm just wondering, you know, your organization has made any specific efforts to raise consciousness in the community, in the neighborhood, as to how things are different here, and instead of something
that's
like
what home. They do. They've actually come out, and I think Dr. Pandya had organized a session at one of the Hindu centers. So whenever an opportunity has been provided, you know, ours, Mona and Nini and Bindu have gone to the centers and educated what services are available. But it's also the view of the community. You know, they don't trust. When you say you're coming and it's government funds, you know, there is that barrier of, oh, you know, they'll ask me to show all my life documents. And I don't want to do that. You know, even this family that I'm talking about, where the gentleman is 84, and we said, you know, complete your Medicare D paperwork. Let's just review what you have so that we know that you have the coverage you need, so that we can hook up with the services when you need them. And it was like pulling teeth to get him to review even if they are eligible for Medicaid. And just to complete the epic application, to get him to bring us his documents so that we could review it to see if we should complete the epic application, and he was eligible for epic, did not happen. Because there is that fear, and they do not want to share their personal information.
Fear of
many of them are, you know, in the family there are someone or the other is in the process of migration.
Okay.
And when you're in the process of migration, you're in a very scrutinized
yes.
Way of your life and your documents and your finances and your paperwork, and they don't want to deal with it. They would rather, they take their Medicaid application to the lawyer. You know it. You know, when they have to complete the applications, they don't trust the social workers. It's very hard for a social worker to get someone to bring the papers, but they'll go to the lawyers and do it. Because they need to verify that it will not impact on my immigration. So, you know, we have immigration lawyers who are experts with the benefit applications.
Makes sense.
I can make a small suggestion.
Yes.
There are a number of Indian newspapers here, India Abroad, News India, things of that sort. And I regularly look at them. And very seldom, you know, you find any coverage of this particular population.
Yes.
And, you know, their needs and aspirations and all that. Since you people are active in that area, I would suggest that, you know, perhaps establish some liaison with these publishers and make sure that there is some, at least some coverage on these issues.
They are, yes, they're out there. And everyone reads them. And especially the seniors, because they're home all week and they wait for the weeklies and the dailies to arrive and they scan everything that's written in them. But guess what? To get, this is an ad, we have to buy the spot. Pragati's budget is 60,000 a year. One ad, one quarter page ad is 700 for Desi Talk. We can't afford it. You buy the ad space and that's the only way you get the word out. To do an article, there has to be a scandal. I have to scandalize the issue. They will go through, they will wait for a story of elder abuse. And then they will write it up. But then again, they will not write up about the services that are out there. Because then they say, oh, we are advertising. You know, we are not going to put your number in. So it's a business they run. Am I wrong? You have to buy your spot.
What happens is a selfish question. My mother is 82, 83 years old. She
lives
with me most of the time, but half of the time she goes to India. She's in India right now. What happens if she doesn't respond to this 15th, you know, whatever?
You're going to have to pay some penalties, I think.
Yes.
And if she does have Medicare and she already has an HMO, then she will be auto-assigned. They probably already assigned her.
Okay.
You need to see that the HMO that she has is going to, if she's taking any prescription drugs, you need to see that the HMO is covering those particular prescriptions.
Okay.
And then if a situation changes and prescriptions may change a year later or 6 months later, you need to really do an analysis on whether the HMO will continue to cover changes in prescriptions or you would need to change her HMO.
I think it's so complicated. When she comes, she should sit down with
the
social worker.
Yes, it takes 2 to 3 hours.
It is not
with an elderly. If they themselves want to understand and complete the application, my staff has spent over 2 hours on time.
Yes, that's true.
Well, thanks very much.
You're most welcome. I'll leave these here and feel free to.
Have a good class. We'll continue with.
Thank you so much. Thank you so much for having me.
Next.
Dr. Pandey,
yeah, but I'm looking for...
Description, don't worry.
No, a little bit.
That's okay. I will introduce myself in two lines, you know, it's long there.
Thank you.
I found it. If I don't do this...
Okay, you will say, you didn't do your job, okay.
And as you know, Dr. Pandey is an MD. He is the president of National Indo-American Association for Senior Citizens. Dr. Pandey is an Indo-American physician, a board-certified psychiatrist, has been practicing in the United States since 1962. In his 30 years with the New York State Psychiatric System, he held many senior clinical and administrative positions. His subspecialties include addiction, forensic, legal, major psychiatric illness, and transcultural psychiatry. And there's more to it.
Yeah, you can read it at least, right? If you feel like. Maybe if you like my talk, then you will read. Otherwise, you can throw it away. I am going to have a little different approach. First of all, let me just tell you about my frustration. I always, when I go and talk to a group, I say, who am I talking to? So I tried to find out. I wasn't able to get good answer. I thought I would have consumers, seniors coming here. I don't see any of them. So basically, I think this group is people who are providing services, either clinical or professional administrative services. Is that a fair assumption? Okay. I am also a physician, so I am in the same kind of business, you know. I have been associated with senior programs, senior services for 10 years or so. And I'm going to tell you kind of approach that I have found useful. Because we have this model of provider and consumer, doctor and patient, client and social worker. I start out with a more egalitarian approach. And it has worked out to me very well. These people that I deal with, they are older, happen to be older because they were born before me. And I am older than you because I was born before you. That doesn't make us any better or worse. We also know that there are some health issues that usually comes about because we live longer. But on the other side, look at the positive. The people I deal with, and that would, I'm sure, these people have raised kids, you know, like you and me, and they did pretty decent job. They have worked outside, sometimes in a very good position. They have a lot of experience and wisdom. And my approach is empowering these people, creating a partnership with them, say, look, I am no better. I just happened to come here early so I can drive, and you don't know how to drive, but you can learn as much as well as I can. It took me a couple of years. No, it wasn't that much. To get my driver's license, it might take you that much. It doesn't. But unless you start, you are not going to get it any different than anybody else. You are no worse than anybody else. But if you don't want to drive in New York City, it's not a big deal. If you are going to same temple, same senior center, it's the same bus going same time, same place. What's a big deal? You can do it. In our senior program, there are a lot of senior citizens who take public transportation and come regularly. So instead of emphasizing, you are old, or you have arthritis, I know you can't come, my approach is, we all have problems. And we all have assets. Sometimes our assets are different, our liabilities are different. And if you use your asset and willing to learn a few new tricks, you can make this home your new home, America, a very enjoyable and satisfying experience. Now, as a end of it, the program that I was instrumental in getting started, I don't go anymore. It's run by somebody who was an engineer in a farm in India, somebody who was a businessman there. They do superb job, probably a little bit better than what I would have done all by myself. They know their needs, priority, budgeting, everything that is required of your organization. So this is my experience, empowering them, create an egalitarian institute so that they can start out with a positive approach. And that's why I like the title of the conference. It talks about wellness. It doesn't talk about handicaps. Okay, so let's have a positive approach. Second thing a point that I think I'd like you to take you back is our heritage. You know, we come from Eastern culture, Hinduism, Buddhism, all these religions. They are very old tradition. We have a great deal of tradition of suffering, tolerating, doing without. And we need to learn a little bit more. And you know, what I say is that it's great philosophy because there are a lot of things that in life you can't change. So don't sweat, don't make yourself miserable after that. But don't overlook the things you can do. And there are plenty of things that you can do. So not a kind of pessimistic attitude, but a measured optimistic attitude and approach to our life. That's why, you know, we have a lot of people who go to social service themselves. They are not waiting for social worker or somebody to take them. So it takes longer time. The worker in the Department of Social Service doesn't understand too well. Too bad. That's what you are paid for. You know, you are paid to deal with foreigners or people of foreign origin. That's what you are paid for. People take care of their own business. So, you know, empowerment and now the health attitude. Some of the things that we see sometimes is people tolerate their illness too much. What can you do? You are old. I got to have hearing problem. That's No, you can do something about it. So you make them aware that you got to look into what you can do, not just accept your fate. And there are a lot of things they can do to make their life better. Okay? The third point is, we all come from tradition of healthcare in India and China and Oriental country. You know, herbal medicine, holistic medicine. And this is fine, it's part of us. But we all tend to overvalue what we have brought with us and sometimes undervalue what new things are available to us. So maybe this is my physical bias. People, senior come and say, "Doctor, I don't like to take these chemicals. I have diabetes, I'm going to go on herbal medicine and it's going to be fine." I don't have knowledge about herbal medicine. I do know that they don't have the rigorous research that Western medicine has. So I'm not going to say don't take it. But if you have diabetes, you better check your blood sugar regularly. If holy water of Hudson cures your diabetes, more power to you. But your sugar is not under control. All this ancient herbs that our parents has been using for 2,000 years is no good. It's still going to kill you. So try to see that they don't over-depend on traditional medicine. It has its place. But there is that tendency, partly because of the economic reason too, but partly because of pride and... So that is something that we got to, the question does come to me about traditional medicine. Something that we talked about earlier is, we are all going to die, I'm sorry to give you news, you know. But something that we never think, want to think about. There's an Indian scripture. And the whole thing starts out with, a story where somebody is going to die and he doesn't want to think about it. And then he has only 8 days to live. Because now it has been... And then he becomes a very spiritual person. The whole scripture is written on it. We can have accident tomorrow. And earlier, a lot of you were here in the session that we had before. If we are going to have accident tomorrow, we are not going to know today. You and I can be dead tomorrow. And if you have those end of the life document or late age document ready, it doesn't do any harm. It doesn't, you know, it's done for good. And I'm sure half of the people here don't have those kind of documents done. And we are all educated people. Now, it is less so with the people who come from other cultures. They don't do it, they have never heard of healthcare proxy and advanced medical director. And as our approach has been in our center is to tell people why it is good for you and good for your children. And good example I give, say, suppose I go in coma tomorrow. I have son and daughter and a wife. And I said, I will create a lot of headache for them because they are going to try to figure out what I would have liked to do at the end of life. Yeah, because each has their emotional reason. I'm going to leave a mess for them. So what's wrong with writing a directive now? And people say, "Oh, yeah, I know, everybody says we should do it. I want to do it, Ashwin Bhai, you know, that's my first name. So, you know, let's do it one day." So what we do is we say, you and your family and your son and daughter, anybody can come because they all need it and they are all going to die. But don't tell them because they won't come otherwise. And we'll do a kind of group workshop. So we had about 70 people in that session. About 55 people went home with those documents. And my daughter happens to be lawyer. I'm a physician and psychiatrist. We can answer all the questions. I said, ask all the questions. But when the questioning is over, this is the form. I will tell you that on line number 2, that blank requires your name. You don't need to read everything. If you want to, read at home. Line number 6 requires person who is going to make decision on your behalf. People say, oh, my son and daughter, who is, maybe if I don't leave my son's name, it's not good. You know, people are not great. You try to say, okay, write down what comes to your mind now is most possible answer. You can always change. All you need is a blank page with little writing. You know, so then at the end, of course, you need someone to witness it. I said, this is why we are doing it in the group. There are going to be people here, they are not your family, they are not going to benefit. You know them because we come to the same center. They can be your witness and you can be their witness. At the end of the day, about 3-4 hours, these people have advanced medical directive, healthcare proxy, durable hour of veterinary, and about, I'm very proud to say, about 25 people filled out organ donation form. Now this is, to me, public health approach to the issue that needs to be addressed. And we have done workshop like that, not in a big number, 5 people, 10 people, 15 people. We have done it for more than 100 people. So I think that's one of the things that if you can arrange in the group that you are dealing with, I think it will be great service. So basically, to summarize what I have been trying to say, the right approach to people who happens to be senior, more senior than us, more empowerment, more egalitarian, more respect, and right education and right action will certainly make their life more fulfilling, more satisfying, and happier. And I think we can be their partner in accomplishing that. Okay, I'm ready for questions if you have any.
Thank you, Dr. Pandya. We have a reception at 4:30, so we have 10 minutes for discussion, comments, observations.
Oh, by the way, the organization that I represent, National Indo-American Association for Senior Citizens, it really gives information and facilitate development of the senior programs in the Indian community. I happen to have 4 newsletters, gives the idea about where are the...
For the pass it on?
Yeah, well, there are only 4, so only people 4. Who really are going to use it, take it, okay? People who really want it, because... And these are the kind of workshops you can pass to the same people, workshop and seminar we have. So it gives you familiarity about our organization. But yeah, I'm ready for any question.
Okay. Be sure, have questions, comments.
Okay, I guess it was either too good or too impertinent or it's too late.
I may have something.
Oh, sure.
Okay. Going back to the earlier point, how do you confront that issue yourself in whatever you are doing? You know? Because it's very difficult to attract, you know, like you're saying yourself, Indian Americans, particularly senior citizens, to participate in this kind of situation.
This kind means?
When it comes to writing a will.
Oh, I see. Okay. Me and my family, you know, we did about 20 years ago this thing.
Mm-hmm.
You know, and I'm in high 60s. So I was up around 40s, and my kid did about the same time,
mm-hmm.
and they were then 20s. Again, as I say, I told them, there's no harm, you are not going to die early because you make it up. and then maybe a few days later, we had kind of family get together, and I got my brother, sister in, everybody said, look, this is what we are going to do, I have forms ready. And if you don't want to attend, you can just have a good time in the kitchen.
So you have to really persuade them very hard to do it.
No, I didn't take that time. You have to remember, a lot of times you create a structure. People have little bit desire and little bit resistance. And if you create the structure, people want to do it.
Mm-hmm.
It gets done. And then you will know that you are not going to get anything out of it, and they would hopefully get something useful out of doing it. People would do it. But you don't say, come next week, ask me questions now. They can always ask questions later on. So we did it several times like that, yeah. Okay. Thank you for listening. And by the way, you know, I don't know what, did you know what program you are coming to, by the way? This gave something that blew my mind. Senior citizen and other ethnic groups. And I don't know what this is about. Do you understand what it says? It means? I mean, I don't understand. Well, on the internet, you know, I had little more clearer title, so that's what I prepared. But I guess you said, as long as we are going to stick around, we might as well attend this program. So thanks for...